Let us pray. Father in heaven, we are awed in your presence, and we are overjoyed, and we give you glory, because but for you, but for your grace and mercy upon us, we would not be here right now. And so thank you. And today we pray that your power would move within our hearts and be evident in this place as we celebrate the Lord's death until he returns. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
You may be seated. Today I have the privilege of offering the welcome. And I just want to say how beautiful you are looking today. You know, as I thought about what to say to welcome you to church, I think about that great day when we will be welcomed into heaven. And I pray that we will all live for this. Live for the day when Jesus Christ, your Savior, will say to you, "Welcome, my good and faithful servant." So for those persons joining us online, thank you for making Moncton Church a part of your worship experience. Visitors in our midst today, thank you for being a part of our service today. I also want to let you know that we practice open communion, so if you're a baptized member, you're welcome to take part in our communion service as well. Regular members, man, what would Moncton Church be without you? Thank you for showing up every week. Thank you for the brotherly and sisterly love that we all share. This beautiful family of Moncton SDA Church, I welcome you. This is a part of the service where we all get an opportunity to take part, prayer, where we get the opportunity as a church to pray together, to make our petitions known to Christ. So as the music begins, please ready your hearts to pray as we engage in corporate prayer. You're also reminded that if you feel so impressed, you can come to the altar. Our loving God and our Savior. The privilege that we have today to come together as a church to kneel in prayer is so wonderful. Even as we reflect on our lesson study, our minds are drawn back to the dark ages when Christians had to run to and fro because of what they believed in. We reflect on the many individuals who gave their lives because they would not flinch from their belief. They gave their lives because of the truth that they held. Today, Lord, we have the freedom to gather. We have the freedom to express our faith. We have the freedom to be here, and we thank you. For many have come from different circumstances this week. We're from different homes, different locations, different towns, different cities. And so, Lord, there are people in our midst today who are in pain. There are people online who are in pain. They're sick. They're battered and abused because of life circumstances. And we dare not forget them, Lord, in our prayers today. For we know that we serve a God who is touched with the feelings of our infirmities. I know that we serve a God who is able to heal, who is able to restore, who is able to bring peace even
to the most disastrous of circumstances. So whatever the storms that rage in the lives of our members, in the lives of those who are watching from home because they can't make it here today, whatever circumstances that they're going through, Father, we place every single person before the foot of your cross today. And as you invited us to come boldly to your throne that we may receive grace, we pray for grace for each individual. We recognize, O God, that besides sickness and disease, pain, that there are individuals who are living today who are very anxious because of the times that we're living in. They're facing financial difficulties. They're facing social difficulties. They're facing mental health crisis. God, there's no shortage of issues in this life. But we praise you, God, that before there was a problem, you were the solution. And so today, even though these circumstances exist, even though our members are in pain, even though we go through difficulties, we can say, it is well with our soul because you live. And so today, Lord, as we prepare ourselves to partake of these emblems, to take part in this communion service, to signify a renewal of our faith and our commitment to you, I pray that you prepare each member, each individual. I pray, God, that your Holy Spirit even now will visit each heart, that you will convict each heart, that you will touch and comfort each heart. And may today, God, as we partake and as we leave this place, we will leave revived, refreshed, knowing that we have been in the presence of the Lord. Mighty God, the enemy might just be here, but I pray that he will have no dominion in this space today. May your name be glorified. Father God, send angels that excel in strength to build a hedge around this place so that no one will be distracted, that no one will leave this place without their full portion of blessing that you have prepared for us. And Father, we know as a people that you're coming soon. We know that your coming is very soon. We know, God, that life is so short and so uncertain. And I pray, God, that in a very special way, that you will speak to each of our hearts today, that we may do everything that we can to accept the sacrifice that you have made on Calvary's cross for our salvation. Save us all, I pray. Be with the proceedings of this service. In Jesus' name, amen. Before I take my seat, I'd like to invite the deacons to come forward for the offertory. Thank you. Today's offering is for the Maritime Conference Advance. It reads thus: Stewardship of our temples. Spiritual element, do you not know that your bodies are the temples of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not of your own. 1 Corinthians 6, verse 19. The individual is a temple of God. In comparison to the Bible sanctuary, living temples, you are bought at a price. Therefore, honor God with your bodies. Proper management of the body's temple, mind, body, and soul via healthy living is essential. Follow a daily health plan for improvement of life. A good steward will consistently practice the 8 laws of health. and we know those quite well. Nutrition, exercise, water, sunlight, temperance, air, rest. The Sabbath is included, and trust in the divine power. Our bodies are his temple, and he expects us to manage and care for them to his glory. Let us pray. Loving God and our Father, we pray for a blessing upon each individual and upon each and upon the offering that will be collected today. May every cent go towards advancing your work, go towards fulfilling the gospel commission, and may your coming be hastened, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, we'll be blessed with special music by Sister Elizabeth.
And when he 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 24. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me."
Verse 25. After the same manner, also he took the cup, and when he had supped, saying, "This cup is a new testament in my blood. This do you as often as you drink it in remembrance of me."
Let us pray. Eternal God, we praise you so much for your body, which was broken for us, broken so that we might be mended together. And as we partake of this emblem of your broken body, which is broken to heal us and to cleanse us of all our unrighteousness, we pray that this may be meaningful and that it may evoke emotions of joy, it may evoke emotions of peace and of newness within us. Thank you for this experience, and we pray that you may continue to bless us abundantly. In Jesus' name, amen.
Loving Lord, we thank you for the sacrifice on the lowly hill of Golgotha, where your blood was spilled for the remission of our sins, where you stood in our place to bear the shame, the guilt, and the pain that we were to bear. You bore it all. Thank you, Lord. We pray for a blessing on the emblems, but more so a blessing on every single individual that will partake. May the power of your blood extend to us even today to wash us of our sins and our iniquities, and maybe be one with you by the power, by in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
The blood that Jesus shed for me way back on Calvary, the blood that gives me strength from day to day, it will never lose its power, for he reaches to the highest mountain, and it flows to the lowest valley. Oh, the blood that gives me strength from day to day, it will never lose its power. It soothes my doubt and calms my fears, and it dries all of my tears. For the blood which gives me strength from day to day, it will never lose its power. Oh, it reaches to the highest mountain, and it flows to the lowest valley. Oh, the blood which gives me strength from day to day, it will never lose its power. For it reaches to the highest mountain, and it flows to the lowest valley. Oh, the blood which gives me strength from day to day, it will never lose, it will never lose, it will never lose its power.
BB, have all been served? Did we miss anyone? Have all been served? Have all been served? Okay. All right. Amen, somebody? Amen. This symbol, which we call bread, some call a cracker, some call a wafer, whatever your fancy, whatever your desire, is a symbol of the sacrifice, the broken body of Jesus. for those of us who may be living with sensitivity or allergy to gluten. Today, thankfully, our deacon ministry made available gluten-free options for all of us. The taste may be different, but the symbol remains the same. Amen? And so as you masticate, as you break it to smaller bits, remember the torture that the body of our Savior endured so you and I could have what we don't deserve, eternal life in His eternal kingdom. Partake all of it. As you're giving thanks for His sacrifice by His broken body, in the other hand, you have a cup with some grape juice. It is sweet because life with Jesus gets sweeter as the days go by. It gets sweeter because we're one day closer with each new morning to His return, made possible by the blood. But it's also red, symbolic of His blood that cleanses us from all sin. Give thanks as you partake. That's why we need Jesus Christ, because we're human. What do you say? We make mistakes, but God forgives and gives grace. Amen? You can leave your cups right there in the receptacle in front of you. They'll be collected after. This time we will continue worship as our praise team leads us in some singing. While we veil the table as well during the praise and worship.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. Our first song is Whiter Than Snow, 318. Lord Jesus, I long to be perfectly whole. I want Thee forever to live in my soul. Break down every idol, cast out every foe. Now wash me and I shall be whiter than snow. Whiter than snow, yes, whiter than snow. Now wash me and I shall be whiter than snow. Lord Jesus, look down from thy throne in the skies and help me to make a complete sacrifice. I give up myself and whatever I know. Now wash me and I shall be whiter than snow. Whiter than snow, yes, whiter than snow. Now wash me and I shall be whiter than snow. Lord Jesus, for this I most humbly entreat. I wait, blessed Lord, at thy crucified feet. By faith for my cleansing I see
whiter than snow. Amen. Our next song is 337, Redeem.
Redeemed, his child and forever I
Our next song is 493. Fill My Cup, Lord.
Into the word. Hope it's been a blessing for you so far as we remember our Lord's sacrifice until he returns. Every Sabbath that we celebrate communion, we are one quarter closer to seeing our Lord and King. What do you say?
Amen.
That's why we do it every quarter. One day we might do it a little more often, but for now, every quarter. Amen?
Amen.
But it's a way of remembering that his promise is true. Stand with me. As you read with me, find in your Bibles John chapter 1, verse 29. John chapter 1, verse 29. As you see, the message is titled for today, The Blood. John chapter 1, verse 29. Now read from the New King James Version. And the Word of God says, The next day, John saw Jesus coming toward him and said, Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. You may be seated. Father, in this moment I pray our hearts are receptive to hear your word. We have given thanks through the communion emblems for the immense sacrifice that paid our sin debt. And now help us now through your word as the Holy Spirit imparts understanding that Jesus' mission for his bride, the church, will be accomplished today. That we will become more perfect as you are perfect. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. Amen. John the Baptist was born for this moment. As we saw in last week's lesson, my friend, our brother Leroy, who we came to church with my family today, we're talking about last week's lesson. How one of the days, Elder Brown mentioned that irrespective of our physical conditions, our ailments, or lack of, or perfect health, we each are born or have been born in this world with purpose. And so John the Baptist had purpose. He was born for this moment, right here in John chapter 1, verse 29. John the Baptist discerned that his plain providential purpose was to simply do this, prepare the way for Jesus. So in Matthew 3, verse 11, the baptizer said, "Indeed, I baptize you with water unto repentance, but he who is coming after me is mightier than I." He said, I'm not even worthy to unloosen his sandals. He said, he will baptize you with the Spirit and with fire. And then in John 3, verse 30, John the Baptist said, he must increase. Everyone say increase. But I must decrease. When John the Baptist sees Jesus, he prophetically and emphatically enunciates, "Behold, Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." Truth is, John's statement is loaded. Here is why it's loaded. It begins with the word "behold." Now, John first saw Jesus, obviously. Then he told everyone else to look upon Jesus. The fact is today, church family, that it would have been difficult for John to convince the crowd to look upon Jesus if he hadn't seen Jesus first. Do you agree? So the application to you and I today is that you and I can invite others to come to Jesus because we have experienced Jesus first for ourselves. If that's the truth for you, say amen. Amen. The second thing John's statement says, he continues from "behold" to say "the Lamb of God." And the context here, the Lamb of God, painted a picture in the minds of his hearers here in John chapter 1 of a sacrificial lamb. And so John seems to suggest here that Jesus is the perfect fulfillment of Old Testament reference to sacrificial lamb. As a matter of fact, I suggest by the authority of God's word today that Jesus is the lamb slain from the foundation of the world. What do you say? Suggest today that Jesus is the slain lamb in the Garden of Eden to cover the nakedness of Adam and Eve. That Jesus is the Passover lamb for Israel in the Old Testament. That Jesus is the Lamb of God who he would provide for Abraham as a substitute for Isaac. That Jesus is Isaiah's lamb to the slaughter. And so by their death, each of these lambs in the Old Testament testified that a greater sacrifice was yet to come, Jesus, the Lamb of God. The third thing that John says in the statement, his introductory statement to Jesus, is that he who takes away the sin, everyone say sin, of the world. Notice that John did not say sins of the world, but John said sin of the world, suggesting today that the Levitical sacrifices by faith, that one sacrificial lamb per day, could only provide cover for the sins of one person per day. But that Jesus, the Lamb of God, provides cover for the collective sin of the whole world. What do you say? In other words, as one commentator suggests, the entire guilt of humanity was collected into one and placed upon Jesus. But John's declaration goes deeper. Because God is not just concerned about covering sin. He wants to remove it completely.
completely. Illustration for you. Pubescent teens understand that the process of biology that is maturing into adulthood unfortunately includes unpleasant at times body odors, which necessitate personal hygiene. Anyone witnessing that in the house today? Y'all are quiet. See, you can't simply put on body odor. You can't simply cover it up with Coco Chanel perfume or with Old Spice body spray. Someone knows that BO smells worse when it's covered up. That's a fact. But the truth is that if you want to eradicate the smell, you've got to remove the odor-causing bacteria by taking a shower. And so, yes, 1 Peter 4, verse 8, the love covers a multitude of sins. It is true that Proverbs 10, 12 says, hatred stirs up strife, but love covers all sins. But understandably, if sin remains covered and unaddressed, sooner or later its stench will reach the surface. What do you say? And so in the Greek, John joins the expressions bear and take away, suggesting that Jesus bears sin. But then Elder Andre, he also takes it away. Somebody say praise God. To understand how Jesus takes away sin, we must go to the sanctuary. Had a graphic, I'm not sure if it's going to be up, but if not, just Google it. There it is. There it is, the sanctuary. And we notice that the priests and those who would bring their sacrifices would enter the sanctuary, the outer court, and approach the altar of burnt offering where the sacrifice was killed. And then from there, we have the laver, symbolic of the cleansing that the sacrifice brings. Amen? But then we move to the holy place and we have the lampstand on the left side, symbolic of the light that comes from God's word through the impression and inner working of the Holy Spirit. Amen? But then we also have on the right side the table of showbread, bread renewed every morning, because we can't have the same stale faith in Jesus from yesterday. We must have a new experience every morning. What do you say? And then we have the altar of incense, symbolic of the sweet rising aroma of the prayers of faith of God's righteous sons and daughters. And then we have the veil between the holy and the most holy. And within the most holy is the ark of the covenant or the testimony, symbolic of God's universal throne. And under that throne is a copy of his holy law, symbolic of his sovereignty and ownership and authority over the universe. What do you say? And so, looking at the sanctuary, Leviticus 5, stay with me. If an Israelite sinned, they would have to bring a lamb to the priest. They couldn't afford a lamb. They were too poor. They had to bring two doves or two pigeons and lay their hand on the head of the lamb and confess their sins, thus transferring their sins or the guilt of their sin to the lamb. And after doing that, the lamb was killed, the blood was drained, and the priest sprinkled some blood on the side of the altar of burnt offering. The rest of the blood was poured around the base of the altar of sacrifice. Stay with me. Thus, by doing that, that person's sin guilt was transferred from the person to the sacrifice and then to the sanctuary. Once they sanctuary. And then Leviticus chapter 4. If the anointed priest sinned, we're all human, aren't we? That's why I got to pray for your pastoral staff. That's why I got to pray for our wider church leadership and for each other. Don't raise each other on too high a pedestal based on how the nominating committee reports. Because the truth is, we're all works in progress. What do you say? And so Leviticus chapter 4, if the anointed priest sinned, then he would have to offer a young bull as a sin offering. He would do the same thing, confess his sins, transferring the guilt of those sins to the bull. And then the bull would be killed. Some blood would be sprinkled seven times before the veil, separating the holy from the most holy. Some blood was then put on the horns of the altar of incense, and the rest of the blood was poured around the altar of burnt offering. Thus, this priest's sin was transferred to the sacrifice, and then by the sprinkled and poured blood from the sacrifice to the sanctuary. You all see a pattern here now? And then Luke chapter 4, and then Leviticus 4. If the whole Israelite community sinned the same sin together, the anointed priest would offer the same sacrifice as he did for himself, transferring Israel's sin, common sin together, from Israel to the sacrifice, the bull, and then from the bull to the sanctuary. In all instances, covering was provided, meaning forgiveness, Brother Olu, and transferring of sin, justification, was made possible by the blood. Everyone say the blood. But notice that entrance to the sanctuary was only made possible by the blood. You had to shed blood to access the laver. You had to shed blood to access the lampstand, the table of showbread, the altar of incense, the most holy place. The blood made the way. Everyone say blood. Great controversy. Page 418 says that the blood represented the forfeited life of the sinner. The truth today is that every time I choose to sin, I forfeit life. In other words, when I choose to sin, I am choosing death over life. And so every time an Israelite or the nation sinned, sacrifices had to be offered, blood had to be shed. And these were called the daily sacrifices. But why did life have to be offered and sacrificed and blood spilt every time I sinned in the Old Testament? As Hebrews 10 suggests, the daily sacrifices were insufficient and incapable of taking away sin. The daily sacrifices didn't make the people perfect. They were simply an act of faith, looking forward to the perfect once and for all sacrifice of Jesus' shed blood on the cross. That's why Hebrews 10 verse 1 says that all these were a shadow. Everyone say shadow. Of the good things to come. I need two volunteers quickly. Two volunteers, doesn't matter what, male, female, boy, girl, need two volunteers. Don't sit there and look at me like you're shy. I need two volunteers. Two volunteers. Who'll come? Who'll come? Two volunteers. All right, Sister Anna, come ahead. One more volunteer. All right, good. Brother Leroy, first time here. I want to give him a clap. God is good. He's helping with our worship, Sister Anna, as well. All right, come up, come up. Yes, come up. So, you all can't see it too well. So you're going to be my hero, okay?
Okay.
And you're going to be the assassin. Mm-mm. Take my life, all right? But pretend, all right? Pretend. You have family, so do I, so we have life to live still, you know? So you all can't see it too well, but the stage lights are casting shadows behind us. Maybe you can, maybe you can't. But the fact is that you're going to pretend they're going to kill me. And the fact is, I can't rely on my hero's shadow to protect me against flesh and blood. We all sit together? Mm-hmm. So, you're, kill me. Yeah, kill. So, my hero has to come between us in the flesh. And she's a super. She's going to take care of him. She's going to floor him, destroy him. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Praise God. Praise God. Hope you got the picture. The shadow can't protect me. The shadow can't forgive me. It cannot blot away my sin. It can't make me clean. It's only a promissory note or a symbol of what is to come. What do you say? Amen. But maybe you don't hear that too well. So think of this. Remember back in the day when we all got paychecks. Maybe some of you still get paychecks. We all got a paycheck. Look for that every Friday or fortnight or monthly if you're on salary. You got a paycheck in an envelope or whatever, however it was given to you. The paycheck was given to you then. Today we have something called direct deposit. And so some of us still stumble and say paycheck was a direct deposit. See, the paycheck back in the day was not your pay. It was simply a guarantee that you'll get paid once the check is cashed or deposited. So the Old Testament, the daily sacrifices of bulls, of sheep, of goats, and of doves were like the paycheck. They were the faith guarantee of forgiveness given through Jesus' blood as the payment. The paycheck was a guarantee that my living expenses and debts will be paid. But unless the check was cashed, the debts couldn't be paid. And so the good news today is that Jesus cashed the check. Romans 6, verse 23 says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of whom? Is what? Through Christ Jesus, our whom? And the truth today is that you are covered. Turn to your neighbor and say, you're covered. You see, God's got you. Your sin debt is fully paid. 1 Peter 2, verse 24 says that Jesus bore our sins in his own body on the tree of the cross, that we, having died to sins, might live for righteousness, by whose stripes we are healed. But truth is today, friends, that God is not just interested in covering sin. He wants to remove it completely. In the Old Testament, Levitical sanctuary service, once a year, how many times a year? Called the Day of Atonement, the high priest entered the most holy place for the cleansing of the sanctuary as a means of completing the daily ministration throughout the year. You see, sin was transferred multiple times every day, millions of times every day from the priest, his family, the Levites and their families, from the nation of Israel as a whole and individually. Every day, sins were transferred to the sanctuary, the guilt of those sins. And so there had to be a day when the sanctuary was cleansed. According to Leviticus 16, on the morning of the Day of Atonement, two goats, how many? Were brought to the door of the sanctuary. Lots were cast upon them, one for the Lord and one for Satan. The Lord's goat was killed. Its blood was brought to the most holy place where, of the mercy seat, where it was sprinkled before the mercy seat, symbol of God's throne. Blood was sprinkled before the seat. And then the blood was also sprinkled on the altar of incense, symbolically cleansing the sanctuary from the accumulation of sins throughout the whole year. The high priest then laid hands on the scapegoat and confessed over it all the sins now cleansed. And that scapegoat was brought out by a strong man to the wilderness, never to re-enter Israelite camp again, symbolically bearing and carrying away the sins of Israel for the whole year. Stay with me now. Great Controversy, page 419, says that the whole ceremony was designed to impress the Israelites with the holiness of God and his abhorrence of sin, and further, to show that they could not come in contact with sin, listen carefully, that they couldn't come in contact with sin without becoming polluted. Truth is, we can't live double lives. We don't sacrifice bulls, goats, doves anymore. We have a once and for all sacrifice, yes, but the truth remains the same, that not because the sacrifice was made, that doesn't mean that I can live my life anyhow I please. Because once I come in contact and reacquaintance with sin willfully, I can't have that encounter and not be polluted by it. And so on the authority of God's word, Seventh-day Adventists believe that we are living in the antitypical day of atonement. It's antitypical because while the Old Testament yearly atonement was a mere shadow or a guarantee of a cleansing, Jesus' sacrifice and his heavenly ministry today as our high priest is in fact the real deal. Everyone say real deal. Hebrews 9 verse 12 says Jesus entered the most holy place with his own blood once for all. Hebrews 10:10 says that we are sanctified by the offering of his body once for all, according to prophetic interpretation of Daniel 8 verse 14. 18:44, Jesus shifted his ministry from simply covering sin to now cleansing sin from the heavenly sanctuary. And so every time we sin and confess our sin, the blood of Jesus Christ covers us. We're forgiven, yes. Declared righteous, yes. But the record of this transaction remains in heaven. According to Hebrews 9, verse 26, Jesus' mission as our holy heavenly high priest is to put away sin, which means to do away with, to abolish. Stay with me now. According to W.D. Frazee, sprinkled blood in the holy place provides covering, and sprinkled blood in the most holy place is for blotting out or removal or cleansing of sin. The first is a provisional pardon. The second is the exoneration. He continues by saying that why does God not blot out sin as soon as you and I, sinners saved by grace, confess our transgressions? The truth is that God has given us the power of choice. Everyone say choice. And he respects our exercise of choice. If we choose, you and I, to leave our sins in the sanctuary, say to your neighbor, leave your sins where it is. Hopefully in the sanctuary. Jesus will blot them out in the closing work of the judgment. On the other hand, if you and I wish to return to a life of sin, God will not forcibly prevent us, just like he didn't forcibly save us. The sins that we have given up, we can surely take back up again if we choose. And so it seems almost impossible by human standards and judgment to completely stop sinning, doesn't it? To overcome sinful tendencies, doesn't it? In our own human power. What do you say? It seems there is no hope from moving from covering to cleansing, from pardon to exoneration. But I have good news. Do you want to hear it? I have great news. Do you want to hear it? The news today is that the blood has made a way. Romans 8 verse 11, there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ. Verse 1, who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. And verse 11 says, but if the Spirit of him, that's Jesus, if his Spirit, the Holy Spirit, who raised Jesus from the dead, dwells in you, that he who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. And so the other part of the good news today is, friends and church family, that you and I have got all the power dwelling within us. Everyone say all power. The truth is our will must align with and connect with the power the Holy Spirit gives. He will give the power to overcome all kinds of addictions. He gives power to overcome a lying tongue. He gives power to overcome gossip and hatred. He gives power to overcome hypocrisy, you name it. The Holy Spirit has given and made available all power within you to overcome, because in our flesh, we are weak. But in our weakness, praise God, his strength is made perfect. And so sadly, despite having free access by the Holy Spirit, the offertory reading for today said that we are the temples of the Holy Spirit. That's why in that same passage from the Word, the Lord says through the Apostle Paul that we should flee sexual immorality, because our bodies belong to the Holy Spirit. He indwells our body temples. And so we violate it by sexual immorality and other sins. So we are his body temple. And despite the fact that each one of us as children of God, born again, blood-washed children of God, not only have the Holy Spirit in the sermon beside us, alongside us, but also within us. He wants to indwell us. He wants to live within us. Despite the fact that we have this promise and fulfillment in our lives, the sad truth is that some of us will choose to remain dirty. We'll choose to remain covered and not get cleaned up. We'll choose to wear different hats depending on the circumstance, different clothing depending on the circumstance, different characters. Some of us are spiritually bipolar, depending on the circumstances, because we know how to play the game. We know how to fake and feign holiness, that everyone can say, there goes a child of God. But truth is, the Holy Spirit knows a lie when he sees one. The truth is, the Holy Spirit is here to help us overcome the sinful nature that should be dead. Is here to help us resist the temptation to take up again the sin that belongs in the sanctuary in heaven, the record of it, the guilt of it, which God is trying to clean up. And how's he going to do that? Listen carefully. One day, heaven's laundromat will close. It's the place where we're being cleaned up. The cleansing of the heavenly sanctuary will cease. Christ himself will announce these words, "He who is unjust, let him be unjust still. He who is filthy, let him remain filthy still. He who is righteous, let him remain righteous still. He who is holy, let him remain holy still." You see, Christ is trying to, and I say trying, not that he's unable to do it, but he's trying because his success in cleaning the sanctuary regarding me depends on my willpower to submit to his ability. Y'all with me still? And so he is trying, not a bad word to use, he's trying to clean up the sanctuary by teaching us through the Holy Spirit and empowering us through the Holy Spirit and the Word of God how to get clean. Sometimes we stay there, but he also wants to empower us how to keep clean. What do you say? And so the question for contemplation and for our introspection is, must Jesus stand in the heavenly throne room forever and ever and ever, and life get more unbearable and more sinful forever and ever, taking care of our sins that we keep sending in to the heavenly sanctuary? Last illustration. Y'all know by now that we have a family dog at home. I'm the one that takes most care of him. And so he sees me as the alpha in the house. Not a bad place to be with a dog. Else he'll be the alpha, which I wouldn't like. But we feed him, we brush him, we give him good quality food, we walk him, all those things. He gets all the good treatment. When it's too cold, we bring him in after, you know, maybe half an hour or so he doesn't freeze his paws off, as I'm told dogs do in Canada. Still trying to understand that. But he gets good treatment. But ever so often we go for a walk in the forest, and despite the good food and the grooming and all those things, he will sniff out the deer poo and snack on it. Doesn't matter how often, how many times I try to teach him not to do it, he always comes back with stinky breath that we have to try to clean up with some carrots or some water or something. And it's no wonder in Revelation that the Lord says through the John Revelator that in heaven, I'm going to comment on this now, there will be no one with dog-like characteristics. Dogs return to their own vomit. Dogs will snack on poop. Dogs will sniff things that we would turn and ooze against. And so as Christ is trying to clean us up, the truth is, how willing are we to submit and surrender to his work of salvation? Romans 6, 1 and 2 put it this way. What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? And verse 2 begins by saying, certainly not. Everyone say, absolutely not. And so the question is, or the understanding is, we can and we shall overcome sin and Satan because of the blood of Jesus Christ has given us access to all power. Therefore, let us come boldly to the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and grace to help in time of need. Anyone need help today? Anyone self-sufficient? Anyone all-powerful? If you need help, say help. And so as I close, why did Jesus come to earth? Why did Jesus take on human flesh? Why did he temporarily exchange equality with God for equality with mankind? Why did he die? 2 Corinthians 5, 17-21 says that he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. The Greek suggests that to be held down in sin, to become sin, was to be under condemnation as a sinner. Understand, on the cross, Jesus assumed the guilt for the sins of the whole world as if they were his own. He died guilty for murder. He died guilty as a rapist. He died guilty for sexual immorality in all its forms. He died guilty for adultery, for lying, for stealing, for anger, for rage, for unforgiveness, for doubt, idolatry, hypocrisy, you name it. He died guilty for the sin, but yes, all the sins of the world. Peter put it this way, that he who himself bore our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, having died to sin, might live for righteousness. By his stripes, we are healed. Isaiah puts it this way, but he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities, and the chastisement of our peace was upon him, that by his stripes, we are healed. Ellen White puts it this way, Christ was treated as we deserve, that we might be treated as he deserves. He was condemned for our sins in which we had no share, that we might be justified by his righteousness in which we had no share. He suffered the death which was ours, that we might receive the life which was his. Because with his stripes, amen, somebody, we are healed. So here is the question. How can we, who have received such grace, continue living in sin? Continue defiling the sanctuary while Jesus is trying to clean us up. And so in heaven, Christ is working to grant us complete cleansing from sin by his blood, through the power of the Holy Spirit and the Word. Understand that the same power, the Holy Spirit, God the Holy Spirit, that raised Christ from the grave, that same power is available to you and me today to overcome sin. What will you do with that privilege? If anyone's in Christ, he or she's a new creation. The old things have passed away. Everything has become new. I leave with these words. Lord Jesus, I long to be perfectly whole. I want thee forever to live in my soul. Break down every idol, cast out every foe. Now wash me and I shall be whiter than snow. Lord Jesus, for this I most humbly entreat. I wait, blessed Lord, at thy crucified feet. By faith for my cleansing I see thy blood flow. Now wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. The blood has made the way to salvation. The blood has made access to power over sin available. The blood has paid your debt and mine for the sins that we have committed. The blood cleanses us daily from all sin. The blood is working to cleanse the heavenly sanctuary. Question, simple question for us. Is there anyone today who simply wants to say, Lord, I submit my will to yours. Your will to clean me up. Not just to educate me how to get clean, but your will to educate me how to keep myself clean as the Holy Spirit guides me through the Word. If that's you, and you want to submit your will to God in that regard, I invite you to do something. Come forward, and I'm going to pray with you. If you want to submit your will to God, he's trying to clean us up, thus cleaning up the sanctuary. If you want to submit your will to God, you don't want to be a hypocrite. You don't want to have your sins just covered, but you want to have your sins removed. I'm with you as well. So if that's you, don't just stand, but come forward. Symbol of giving your will to God. A little uncomfortable, but the appeal's for everyone. How many more will come forward, symbolizing, I join my will to the will of the Father. I submit my will, my sinful heart, my two-faced demeanor, the things that I keep hidden from plain view, especially from God's people. I submit the will that's led me down that path to God. There's no shame in that. We all have some kind of skeleton in the closet. Is that true? So if that's you, come forward. If there's anyone as well in the crowd that hasn't yet given your life to Christ through baptism, that's the second step toward achieving cleansing, eternal life. First step is to believe, then be baptized by water. The third thing that happens is the baptism of the Holy Spirit, where he enters your life to give you the unlimited power to overcome sin. So if you haven't yet given your life to Christ, the second step, you believe. But the second step is yet to come, to be baptized by immersion. If that's you, as every eye is closed, every head bowed, come forward as well. I want to pray with you. Maybe you've stepped away from the faith. You want to renew your commitment to God in baptism. I want to pray with you. Amen.
I want to fully.
Amen. Everyone say amen. Amen. Come on, church, say amen. 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 Is there anyone else? She wants to commit by baptism. Is there anyone else? Anyone else for Jesus? Online, if you're joining us and you want to indicate your desire to submit your will to God, just put will in the chat. If you want to be baptized, the second step in salvation. Also, just connect with us on the website, MonctonSDA.org. Contact/contact. Fill out the form. We will get back to you and help you in that second step towards surrendering your life and will to Jesus through baptism. Let's pray. Father, we give you glory and praise for what your word has done within our hearts today. We thank you for the privilege we had of celebrating the Lord's death until he returns. We thank you that Jesus died once and for all, removing the human element for salvation and causing us to understand that the shadow of the good things to come has passed away. Help us to understand that our faith must unite in Jesus. Help us to understand that our wills must unite with yours, that we must make the right choice to leave sin, our sins, forgiven and covered in the sanctuary, and to allow you to clothe us daily in Christ's righteousness. Give us the same measure, even increased measure or intensity of hatred for the old sinful ways that we had. Give us an intense hatred for them that outweighs the love that we had for sinful ways. Today, I pray this blessing on your people. I also ask for our sister and those online, perhaps, who would like to take the second step towards salvation. They believe, yes, but they want to be baptized and surrender all to Jesus. Thank you for their heart's decision. I pray that you continue leading them even now. Lead them now, Lord, to move even now from covering to cleansing. That all in this worship, even those who will watch after the fact, will be able to hail you and welcome you as Lord and Savior. That none will be lost, but all of us will be saved eternally in your kingdom. Thank you, Lord. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. 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 God bless. God bless. God bless.
Shall we all stand for our closing song? 294, Power in the Blood.
Would you be free from the burden of sin? This bar in the blood, bar in the blood. Would you weary will a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder working power in the blood of the
Father and our God, we give you thanks for today where we're able to worship and be in your presence. As we depart one from another, as we leave this place, may your Holy Spirit still abide with each of us. Go with us to our homes. May your blessing, may your name be glorified even in our homes and in our lives. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. You're reminded about the constituency meeting tomorrow at 10 a.m. Please turn up. Thanks.